Thank you so much for having me here. Now I know the only thing more beautiful than Manchester's scenery is its new library, which is just lovely. And it's so heartening as a book lover and a lover of learning that so many people would turn out on a beautiful summer evening to talk about Ukraine and Russia. So I'm just thrilled to have everyone here. And I've been told to try to talk slowly, which for me is difficult, but I will try. I think some of you might have seen my colleague, Ferioz Ojakli here earlier in the year when he spoke about ISIS, and he and I have an informal competition as to who can speak more rapidly. So if you made it through him, hopefully you'll make it through me as well. So I titled the talk, Russia and Ukraine, New Answers to Old Questions, because a really significant aspect of this controversy or conflict, which unfortunately has fallen a little bit out of the news recently when it really has not died down, is the supposed kind of ancient roots of this conflict. Both Ukraine and Russia have portrayed the roots of this as something that lies very long in the past. Russia, of course, making the argument that it's just reclaiming territory and rights that were always its. And Ukraine, by contrast, arguing that it is only trying to defend territory and rights that were always its. So we're gonna, through the talk tonight, what I hope we will do is look at some of those claims, look at the historical arguments on both sides. I think the conclusion that I want to come to is that while there are more recent causes or catalysts for this contemporary conflict, it's also just the newest iteration of a conflict that we see happening time and time again, not just between Russia and Ukraine, but also between Russia and take your pick of the former Soviet states, whether it be the Baltics, whether it be the Caucasus, right? Georgia in particular, who had their own issues with Russia back in 08 and 09. So I don't think this is really a new answer to an old question. I think, unfortunately, we're seeing an old answer being replayed again. I'll make the argument that Ukraine is trying something new. Ukraine wants to convince its own people and the international community that it is something new, that it is European, that it belongs in a stable, independent space, free of Russia and united with Europe. That is new. That is different. That is something Ukraine has not really tried before. It's in some ways a compelling argument. I find myself drawn to it because it stands for all these good things like freedom and democracy and human rights. But it is tricky when you consider Ukraine's history, as we will tonight. It's in fact such a new answer that many Ukrainians are not comfortable with it. It's too new. It's too radical. They perhaps want an older answer, which would be, well, we don't want to be part of Russia, but we know we're stuck with them, right? We can't completely cut themselves off and pretend they don't exist. So that's a little bit of a preview of where we'll be going with this. But before we start that, let's just quickly take a look at where we stand right now. First of all, what is the situation on the ground? In a minute, I'll show you a slide. Every day, the National Defense Institute of Ukraine puts out a new map showing where the military engagements are, what borders are open, who is controlled by what. So it's still a very fluid situation in terms of where fighting is. I'm sure you hear, if you have your ears to the radio or to the TV, you know, once in a while you hear about X number of servicemen on either side being engaged in a skirmish or losing their lives. So we'll talk a little about that. It's still a hot conflict. The so-called Republic of Novorossiya, which was declared earlier in the winter, has kind of lost its what was already sort of a weak or kind of ersatz existence. The political project of creating this new area out of eastern Ukraine doesn't seem to have much gumption behind it. Even Russia itself is withholding recognition. They couldn't get any of Russia's allies to recognize it either. So, you know, they're making stamps and flags and things, and thanks to the web, anybody who wants to create any kind of virtual republic can have one now. So it has an internet presence, but the political project is pretty much in the cold freeze right now, I would say. We supposedly have a ceasefire, this so-called Minsk II ceasefire, which neither side seems to be following, and which neither side seems to be very interested in following. So I put it in quotes because it's not clear that it really exists at all, except on paper. And we have some interesting political developments in both Russia and Ukraine right now. As I'm sure you're aware, Russia is particularly sensitive to fluctuations in the oil market. We know those prices continue to go down. That, combined with the continued sanctions that the West has put on Russia, means that the economic situation is quite dire in Russia. Whether or not that will translate into any kind of political unrest, I listen to a lot of Radio Free Europe, which some of you might as well, and a lot of their reporting is great, but a lot of it is also, you have to know where it's coming from. It's obviously a U.S. government-funded source, and, a lot of it is this sort of hopeful, well, the economy's so bad, Putin's got to go sometime. I don't unfortunately think that's true. Russia seems fairly impervious to economic logic, but nevertheless, we do have the economic situation in Russia. In Ukraine, we have... I think something we lose sight of, because of course they too are preoccupied with the conflict in the East, but there is an internal political process going on in Ukraine as well. They are trying to make the political and economic reforms that Europe is demanding of them. They are trying to get their house in order in terms of rooting out corruption in both the political system and the economic system. It's very hard, and that's where, this claim that Ukraine is unambiguously European, Ukraine is ready to join the modern world, and only, big bad Russia is holding it back. Well, would that that were true, right? Ukraine does a pretty good job of holding itself back in terms of having, Soviet-style or Russian-style corruption and things like that. But it's trying. And so, that's the big question for Ukraine, is how sincere are these reforms? How well will they stick, right? And can they do those things when you also have this very traumatic and trying conflict in the East? So that's sort of a sense of where we are. Here's the map I was telling you about in terms of where we actually are on the ground. So you can see the little Ukrainian flags are places that are controlled by Ukrainian forces. Harsh-looking tanks are all Russian forces. These red checkpoints are all controlled by Russia, so we have Russia controlling, checkpoints coming into Ukrainian territory. Here's where the fighting is along this line, and it really hasn't changed much. These will change a little bit every day, but this is really the line of where the daily fighting has been for quite a while. This checkpoint up here, the Ukrainians are quite happy to have gotten that open again and sort of to have taken control of that. So it's interesting to see how this changes every day and how it doesn't. This is just to give you a sense of the smaller or the bigger picture of where we're looking at. This is the disputed area, and down here is Crimea. So I'm going to be showing you a lot of maps in different fonts and different eras, but I just want you to have some sense that, okay, this is modern-day Ukraine, right? Here's Crimea down here on the Black Sea. Here's Russia. Here's where they're fighting right now, because we're going to see how this territory has just changed over time dramatically. And there is not, a clear-cut historical answer to who owns what and who deserves what, and that's why we have this conflict now. It's very similar to what we've seen at different points in history. So we'll look at some of those. So how did we get to this point? A quick recap of how we got to the point where we've got all this fighting. Back in November of 2013, Yanukovych, president of Ukraine, was democratically elected back in 2010 with a whopping 48% of the vote. He was supposed to sign an association agreement with the European Union, which would have brought Ukraine closer to the EU, not a member, but closer. That he was all set to do that and backed out. Ukrainians didn't like this. You'll hear me refer a couple times to a guy named Andrew Wilson, who has written a couple books about Ukraine that I can't recommend highly enough. They're just wonderful. He has a new one called The Ukraine Crisis, which is just really essential on this. And in fact, I'm going to be teaching it in my class at Skidmore this fall. But he says what really brought people out into the streets after Yanukovych decided he wasn't going to sign this agreement with the EU was the loss of hope. It was a sense of betrayal and things like that, but it was just a loss of hope that, Europe represents this future, the possibility of being a normal country, of being a less corrupt country, and, the idea that hope was gone. So they started just coming out and coming out day after day. And it turned into what was called the Euromaidan phenomena, because the Maidan just means square. It was the big public square in Kiev. And they started coming out with EU flags, Ukrainian flags, and the sort of idea that we don't want politics as usual. We don't want this corrupt guy who tells us he's going to sign an agreement with Europe that will hold him to some laws and regulations and then doesn't do it so he can keep stealing and things like that. So they start coming out, and Yanukovych doesn't know what to do. Putin doesn't know what to do. They're not sure. We'll talk a little bit about why they get so spooked when people start coming out into the streets. Things stay relatively peaceful until January, the period of January 22nd to February 13th. You have 9 people killed. That obviously raises the stakes on both sides. People do not turn around and go back into their homes. Instead, they double down, they come out, they build this incredibly well-constructed, well-instituted phenomena called the Maidan, which had hospitals and all kinds of things. And unfortunately, later in February, Yanukovych's response was, and many say at the behest of Putin, was to say, we've got to get them out of here. They're not going in. We tried using a little force that didn't work. We're going to get, oh my goodness. Oh, okay. There we go. Thank you. We're going to use a lot of force now. That's what happened between February 20th and 24th, when over 100 people were killed by snipers. And it was at this point, between February 20th and February 24th, that Yanukovych disappeared and said, okay, well, we've killed all these people. Maybe that wasn't such a great idea. People are not going away. Now people are really angry. What should I do? Do I stay and fight? Turns out, interestingly, he had his bags packed already, which is why he was able to leave so quickly. So he disappears and, shows up later. And at that point, this is when we start to see a real political process begin as well, right? Yanukovych flees, parliament takes over, and we get this whole sort of dramatic and really heartwarming process in Ukraine. This, though, begins to really spook Putin, right? He can't believe Yanukovych is gone. It's way too close for comfort that this has just happened next door, and we'll talk about why that is. Putin chooses this moment to not just say, this is terrible, this is bad, I can't believe this is happening in Ukraine, but to actually move in and occupy part of Ukraine, which is Crimea. So he annexes Crimea, they have a referendum, not only does he begin to annex Crimea, but we start to see forces, strange forces, nebulous forces, referred to as little green men, who come across the border, and suspiciously they have Russian-made weapons and they all speak Russian and things like that, and we start to see some fighting in eastern Ukraine as well. How is that fighting gone? We have the first deaths in, we have the first deaths in April at the city of Mariupol, which is still at the center of the conflict. In May of last year, Donetsk and Luhansk declare independence. That's when they declare that they are Novorossiya. They have a couple referendums that seem to show that people support that. Of course, last July, the Malaysian airliner was shot down. We just had that sad anniversary. Then we had the first ceasefire in the wake of the tragedy in September. Didn't do much. We had a second try back in February for Minsk, too. Again, that hasn't done much. Overall, we've had about 4,000 casualties, 300 of them since the ceasefire in February. So it's still a very hot topic. So where are we going in terms of the old causes, sort of medium-range causes and more immediate causes for this conflict? The old causes are as simple as, what is Ukraine? What is Russia? What is their relationship? What are the borders of each of these states? How should they be related to each other? Does Ukraine have the right to independence or not? Is it just Russia's little brother, which is how Russia refers to it? And you know, what is the proper relationship? We'll look at the history of this and how this informs decision-making on both sides. More medium-range causes, and these I would date to really the post-Soviet period and even the second post-Soviet decade. The Yeltsin era was pretty much a wash. You remember that? That was, you know, good times there, good times here. We had Clinton and Yeltsin drinking it up and having fun, and everyone was having a good time except the Russians and the Ukrainians, who were in a terrible economic downturn. So really, it's only when Putin comes to office in 2000 that he is in charge again, right, and is starting to get Russia back on its feet. He starts to ask some questions, such as, wait a minute, why did Khrushchev ever give Crimea back, and Crimea to Ukraine, and why didn't Yeltsin ever try to get it back, and wait a minute, what's been going on with NATO? Why are they expanding into our former territory? Why do they want to destroy us? And wait a minute, why is Ukraine cozying up to the EU, right? So once Putin comes to power in the 2000s, he starts asking these questions that Yeltsin just never asked, because he was preoccupied with drinking a lot and hiding his money, which is essentially what he did, and playing tennis and having a couple heart attacks. So he was occupied, so he didn't ask these questions, but Putin starts to ask them. Then we have these much more immediate causes. So this might be, you could refer to this as sort of Putin 1.0. So this is Putin of the 2000s. Putin 2.0, Putin of the 2010s, has a much different agenda. He is starting to feel things much more acutely. He tells Russians in January of 2012, actually tells them a little bit earlier in December of 2011, that he's coming back as president. He had served as president from 2002 to 2006, and then from 2006 to 2010, and then he turns the reins over to Dmitry Medvedev, to 2008. Then Medvedev is allowed to be president from 2008 to 2012, and people think, oh, okay, he'll have one more term, and then maybe, you know, they'll appoint someone else. Well, no, Putin says, I'm coming back. Guess what? I know you missed me, so I'm coming back. And he gets a reaction that he was not expecting at all. These are what are referred to as the Bolotnaya protests, because they start in the Bolotnaya sector of Moscow. And I'll just show you a couple pictures of these protests. So this is not Ukraine. This is actually Moscow, you know, a couple years before Ukraine. So you can see why what happens in Ukraine might be giving Putin flashbacks. He was not prepared for this. He was not prepared for thousands and tens of thousands of people coming out in anger just because he had announced that he was going to be president again. He expected, you know, to be welcomed with open arms. But a lot had changed in those 4 years, right? Even Russians thought, well, maybe we're becoming a normal country. So you saw things like this, you know, this says no to Putin, and here you had somebody showing what Putin might look like after another, you know, 20 years of Putin rule, right? And actually down here it says 2050. You can't see it, it's cut off. Right? But what if we get to 2050 and we're still, you know, have Putin as our president? So people are saying, no, we don't want a president for life. We did that, right? We don't want Putin back. And this gives you a sense. This poster says no to politics by force. And you can see, right, it's, you know, it's young people, it's rainbows, it says freedom. You know, they had thought they were getting, you know, heading in one direction, even if it was slowly and circuitously. And, you know, they found out that they weren't and rebelled. And this really rattled, Putin. And so when he sees Yanukovych fall to similar protests, you know, just a year or two later, you can see why this was so frightening for him, right? This was, oh my gosh, this could happen here again. I have to do something. I have to do something as radical as occupying Ukraine. So, however, he didn't say that, right? He didn't say, oh my gosh, I'm afraid of losing my hold on power, so I'm going to invade Crimea. What he said was, this is, I should have given some excerpts of the speech that he gave in March 2014 when they occupied Crimea, because it was all about how sacred this territory was to Russia, you know, that it was where Russia's soul was baptized, because indeed it is where the Rus, the ancient Slavs, adopted Christianity, right there in Crimea, and we'll see a map of that. So this is the argument that Putin used. This is why this matters, not because I'm afraid of losing my job and getting investigated and thrown in jail for, you know, where all my money has gone and stuff like that, but because this is sacred Russian territory. And so he started referring to Kievan Rus, which is this the proto-Russian state. It's claimed by both modern Ukrainians and modern Russians as their first state. So what is Kievan Rus? It was founded back in the 8th century. It did indeed adopt Christianity in 988 AD. You might have heard that story. It's actually in the great Slavonic chronicles that Prince Vladimir of Kiev invited representatives of the great faiths, right? So Christianity, Islam, and Judaism to come and lobby, basically, because at this time the Slavs are still pagan. And he said, we don't like Islam because you can't drink, and Judaism's Sabbath is too restrictive for us. So we went with Christianity. So that people like to tell that story now, knowing the fondness for drink in Russia. There's been a resurgence of interest in Kievan Rus because modern Ukrainians are making the argument not only that it was proto-Ukraine, but also that back then in the, you know, 9th, 8th, 9th, 10th century, it was part of Europe, such as Europe was back then. It had trade and dynastic marriages with Sweden, with Poland, with the German Empire, with Hungary. It was not cut off. It was not, you know, some Byzantine thumb that was, you know, stuck in this obscure backwater. The argument is that, yes, there were Byzantine influences. It was Byzantium that Christianized them, but that was tempered by these marriages and trade connections to what we would consider Europe at the time. Obviously, if you're a modern Ukrainian trying to make the argument that Europe should give you lots of money and help, you know, you want to make this argument that Kiev was essentially European. So here's a map of roughly what Kievan Rus was back then. So here's, again, there's that Crimean Peninsula I showed you before. Here is right along the Dnieper, right along the Don here is where that fighting line is right now, down to the Sea of Azov. This city here, Chersonesus, is where Prince Vladimir adopted Christianity back in 988. Chersonesus has its own real interesting history. It was a Greek colony founded by the Greeks. So again, if you're Ukraine and you want to impress Europe, you say, well, hey, we're as Greek as you are, right? We have a Greek roots. We have the Greco-Roman heritage. Take us. You know, these are our European bona fides. And you'll notice, right? This is way down here. Moscow, you know, doesn't even show up on this map. Moscow's, you know, way up over here, you know? So Moscow at this point is nothing during the time of Kievan Rus. It's all about Kiev. It's all about this sort of Black Sea region. The trade routes are north-south and obviously along the river routes. Moscow is not much at this time. It's very much a geographically limited area. Oh, this is just, I wanted to show you, this was just a couple weeks ago. This is Putin on the 1,000th anniversary, so Vladimir being the one who adopted Christianity down here at Chersonesus back in 988. This year was the 1,000th anniversary of his repose, when he actually died and was ascended to heaven. So Putin made a big deal of this, dedicated a new monastery in his name, gave another speech about how, you know, this was the birth of the Russian people back 1,000 years ago. So he's very much making this claim that what happened in that little Crimean Peninsula 1,000 years ago was the birth of the Russian people. Ukrainians, others, including Crimean Tatars for that matter, would say that's ridiculous. There were no Russians there at that time. There were Slavs, but they weren't Ukrainian or Russian. But both sides, both Ukrainians and Russians claim that. So Kyiv is going along. It's you know, a European state. It's doing fine. Then, like others at the time, they experience the Mongol invasions. They are cut off from Europe by what are called the devils from the east, right? So we have the Mongol invasions of the early 13th century. Kiev and other cities of Kievan Rus, like Novgorod and Rostov, are all devastated. Remember, the Mongols almost get all the way to Vienna. The Mongols, though, have an interesting way of ruling the territories that they conquer. They're not interested in colonization. They're not interested in religious restrictions. They just want money, you know. So you can practice whatever you want as long as you pay your tax. It doesn't take on the sort of Mongol yoke or Mongol occupation doesn't take on a religious bent until later. So the first raids are 1220, 1230, 1240. Not till 1340 do the descendants of the Mongols actually adopt Islam. At that point, when the Mongols become Muslim, that's when the Mongol occupation starts to take on more of a religious conflict aspect. So it becomes Christianity versus Islam. They become not just these sort of hated overlords that we have to pay a tax to, but they become infidels, right? They become threats to Christianity. And so here's just a map of the Mongol invasions. So here you can see they came to Kiev and the cities surrounding it in 1238, got all the way to Vienna and Hungary in the 1240s. Got a lot of other places too, as we can see. So remember I said Moscow was not much of a city during the time of Kievan Rus. Well, what the Mongol occupations do and the Mongol invasions do is, you know, destroy what Kievan Rus had. You know, very sad story, and that's the story that gets told, right? We were European, we had this wonderful situation, the Mongols came, destroyed it all, we're cut off from Europe. Well, why do they then get cut off from Europe? Why can't they just rebuild and rebuild their ties with Europe? Well, what replaces Kiev is not Kiev, right? The city-state, the Slavic city-state that replaces Kiev is now centered around Moscow. So Kiev remains, you know, it's still got some beautiful architecture and things and centers of learning and religious worship and things like that. But in terms of what city becomes politically and economically more dynamic after the Mongols, it's Moscow. And so we see Moscow really rising in the 15th and 16th centuries under Ivan III and Ivan IV, who is Ivan the Terrible. So we really see Moscow branching out. They're the ones who defeat the Mongols. They're the ones that create this Russian state narrative of, you know, we were something wonderful. They know the stories of Rus, right? Even though they weren't really there, they know the stories. They share religion. They say, we were this wonderful shining state. The evil Mongols came and destroyed us. We are now reasserting ourselves. The first place they take is the city of Kazan in 1552, which is ruled by the descendants of the Mongols. This is where I did my field work, and my trepidatious husband, who's back there, came with me for a year and lived there, and we had a great time. And then we, in 1581, he takes the Khanate of Sibir. He takes the Khanate of Astrakhan, and you really see sort of the modern Russian state begin to grow. It also grows to the southeast. So yeah, it does take over some of what was used to be Kievan Rus, but not Kiev itself. Kiev is in the Kingdom of Poland, as you can see. It also does not take over, I'm sorry it got cut off here, but right here is Crimea, right? This is where Chernesesis is, where this great Christianization happened. Russia can't take that. It is indeed ruled by the Crimean Tatars, who are descendants of the Mongols. So even when Russia is starting its great expansion back in the 16th century, it doesn't take Crimea. It can't. It's too weak. Crimea will not be incorporated into Russia until almost 1800, right? So again, remember Russia's great claim to owning this place. Well, it didn't have it then, it doesn't have it now, right? It won't get it until 1800. So what about Ukraine? So we have, you know, we have the rise of Russia. What is Ukraine now? As you can see on this map, in the 15th and 16th centuries, it's nothing. It's either Poland or Russia, right? The Ukrainian people, such as they are stuck between Poland and Russia. And it's important to remember that at this point, no one's referring to themselves as Ukrainians yet, right? They're referring to themselves as, sometimes they do call themselves Little Russians. Sometimes they refer to themselves as Ruthenians. Sometimes they call themselves Rusins, right? No one has yet formulated an idea of a Ukraine. What Ukraine actually means is borderland, which is a pretty good description of what this area is. It's the border between Poland and Russia, and later on we'll see Turkey. So if you are a Ukrainian person, you know, who are you? Who are you going to become? And you have some options. Your first option is to go with Poland. You got the Kingdom of Poland there. Poland actually is quite a power back then. They have the ties to Europe that you might remember, right? They have links to exciting places like Venice. They have links to rich places like the Vatican. So sometimes Polonization seems like maybe a good idea. There are opportunities. You can become Catholic. You can travel to Rome. You can do all kinds of interesting things. People who, Ukrainian people who end up in this part are often referred to as Galician Rus, or sometimes they're referred to as Red Ruthenians. And so a good chunk of what later will become Ukraine ends up living under the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, which is formed in 1569, and they fall under Catholic influence. The Jesuits are very, as we know, the Jesuits were everywhere. I went to a Jesuit college, so I can say that. Jesuits had themselves everywhere, and they were certainly in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, were very happy to convert some of these Orthodox people to Catholicism. And they also brought with them European influence. One of the results is this very interesting thing that happens in 1596, when the Uniate, or Greek Catholic Church, is created, where you have Ukrainians who identified with much of the Orthodox rite, so the rites of the Orthodox service, but they also were very interested in Rome. They were very persuaded by these Jesuit and other emissaries. They were very persuaded by the riches and the opportunities afforded by European culture. So they did this interesting thing where they pledge fealty to Rome, but Rome allows them to keep their own liturgy. So Uniate Catholics pledge fealty to Rome, but their liturgy is different, and they can have married priests and, you know, some of the other things that other Orthodox communities have. And if you, these people we're talking about, you know, who are these people that might take this kind of European Polish option? So, you know, the Kingdom of Poland went all the way up to sort of Kharkiv, Kiev. This is important because you'll see this is a pretty big area of what becomes modern Ukraine, but it does not include places like Donetsk, Dnipropetrovsk, and others, Odessa. This is exactly where that fighting is today, right? So we'll see this part of Ukraine, especially this area here around Lvov and others, they really identify with this European history, this Polish history, these ties to Europe. The other part of Ukraine, which is either part of Crimea or, you know, is part of Russia, is less sure about that. So what's your other option? Your other option is to seek the patronage of Moscow. These folks would be wary of the westernizing influence of Catholicism, right? Those shifty Jesuits, those shifty Catholics, they're wary of Polonization. The Poles tend to look down on the Ukrainians. They think the Ukrainians are peasants. They think they're crude. They want to Polonize them. They want them to learn Polish and become Catholic, right? They think they're sort of savage. So maybe you don't like that attitude, right? The Muscovites at least are saying, hey, you don't have to change, right? We like you the way you are. You can keep speaking Old Church Slavonic. You can keep your pure Orthodox liturgy. You don't have to pay any money to Rome, right? You can stay with us. So then you have, this is where you also have Ivan III and Ivan IV, the Terrible, making this claim, basically, making this pitch to the Ukrainians. They claim to be the czars of all Rus. So they start, telling the story that, well, Kievan Rus, way back then, that was ours too, right? Even though we're up here in Moscow, we're going to claim that we are the czars of all Rus, including Kiev. And including Ukrainians. And of course, Moscow, if you want to compete with Rome, Rome is trying to take away some of these Orthodox people, you say, well, you don't have to go to Rome. We're the third Rome, right? So Moscow becomes the third Rome, right? Don't pledge your fealty to some alien Italian pope in Rome, right? Moscow is the third Rome. That's, where your spiritual home is. So that's the other option. Oops, sorry. Okay. Your third option, however, is to say neither of those appeal to us, right? We don't want to be Polish and Catholic. We don't want to be under Moscow's thumb, right? Because despite what Moscow says, it was not there at Kiev, right? And we remember having our own state. So maybe we want to have sort of a free or independent Ukrainian identity. This takes a long time to develop, though. You don't start seeing really the word Ukraine until the 18th century. So how do they start to develop this independent sense? A lot of it has to do with the Cossack movement or the Cossack heritage. I'm sure many of you are familiar with that. Cossack comes from the Turkish word Kazak, and it just means free men. So Cossacks, many of you probably read Taras Bulba or saw the Yul Brynner version, right, of Yul Brynner playing Taras Bulba, the film from the 60s. The Cossacks are these free men who live in what is today Ukrainian territory. They are no one's servant, right? They are Orthodox, but they do not want to be hemmed in by the Orthodox Church, and they certainly don't want to be hemmed in by the Catholic Church. There are Cossacks who do live in what we would consider Muscovy, but then there are Cossacks who consider themselves, or we would consider, Ukrainian. Sometimes they were called Zaporozhian Cossacks, sometimes they were called Ruthenian Cossacks. What unites Cossacks is their orthodoxy, right? And they have these common enemies, the Crimean Tatars, the Ottoman Turks. You would also say the Poles at times are their enemies. So the Cossacks are an integral part of the Ukrainian story. They become sort of a kernel, an independent kernel that's not Russian, it's not Polish. It has its own unique culture and history, so we have lots of literature and art around it, right? Gogol's story and others. But it's also tricky because being a Cossack is not synonymous with being a Ukrainian because of all these other things that we've already talked about. There are Ukrainians that identify with Europe. There are Ukrainians that identify with Poland. There are Ukrainians that identify with Rome. There are Ukrainians that identify with Moscow. And there are Ukrainians that identify as Cossacks. So you can see already, Ukrainian history is very complicated, and we're only in the 17th century. So, but anyway, the first Cossack rebellion is in 1648, led by a guy named Bohdan Khmelnytsky. Bohdan means God-given. He is elected hetman, which just means, the head of the Cossack state. So for Ukrainians, if you're a contemporary Ukrainian nationalist, Kiev is your first Ukrainian state. This Khmelnytsky hetmanate, this Cossack state that he creates in 1648, is considered the second independent Ukrainian state. Whether or not it was actually a a true Ukrainian state or not. Again, I'll refer to Andrew Wilson. I apologize for the typo here. My son would be filled with schadenfreude with my typo because I'm always getting on him about his typos. But nevertheless, what Wilson says about this period of this Cossack state or this independent Cossack state is that it provided political space for the consolidation of a new identity. So you really did start to get this sense of there's something that exists that will later be called Ukraine that is different from both, you know, Poland and Russia. So that is important. And this is how big that state was. This is what the Hetmanate looked like. So that Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth that we talked about, that's up here. This Hetmanate, this Cossack state here, you know, really is quite large. It's Kiev. It goes all the way up here, right? It goes up into Cherniv. It has this Zaporozhye. Again, what does it not have? Doesn't have Crimea, and it doesn't have this area, which is, this is modern-day Ukraine over here, right? So again, you can see when Ukraine is talking about its territory, what borders is it going to use? These? You know, it's very ambiguous. Here's a couple pictorial representations of the Cossacks. You might be familiar with this painting. This is Ilya Repin's Zaporozhye Cossacks Write a Letter to the Sultan. It hangs in the Tretyakov Gallery in Moscow. It's huge. It's wall size. It's about this size. A wonderful painting. This is just a detail of it. And you can see, right, you could have a positive spin on this representation, which is look how full of life they are. Look at how, you know, sort of free they are and colorful. On the other hand, you know, they look like they've imbibed a little, they're missing some teeth, they do look rather savage, right? So, you know, you could interpret this two ways, right? What you think of the Cossacks. So what they're doing in this painting is they are writing a letter to the Sultan. The Sultan is trying to tell them, you know, you better submit to me or I'm going to come squash you. And they are laughing at that idea, right? Because they are these strong warriors. Contrast that with this painting just a few years later, 1912. So this is Bogdan Khmelnytsky. He's entering into Kiev to create his state, right? So again, this is a 20th century imagining of that 17th century state. Look at how much more dignified this is, right? He's on a noble white steed. He's very noble, right? Everyone is very pious and upright. So this is a different way of imagining the Cossacks. Not that they were these crazy, you know, drunken barbarians, but that they were upright state builders, right? Who came into Kiev with flags and they had the blessing of the church and, you know, everything was on the up and up. So that's just a couple different visions of who the Cossacks were. So the Cossack state did not last very long, and what we see happening quite quickly after the Cossack state is created in 1648, almost immediately we see it having to make deals with its neighbors. And within a century and a half, it's entirely absorbed either by Russia or the westernmost parts are acquired, as you can see, by Austria. So Russia gets much of the territory of the Cossack state quite early. You know, then it gets later with the division of Poland. But again, it doesn't get Crimea until much, much later. So how does this happen? What are the moments of incorporation of this Ukrainian territory? In 1654, there's what's called the Treaty of Pereyaslavl. This is a disputed thing, very hotly. Is it a military alliance between equals, the Cossacks and the Russians, or is this when the Cossacks became vassals of the Tsar? I bet you can guess who interprets it what way. In 1667, we have the Treaty of Andrusovo. This is when Russia gets Kiev and what is called Left Bank Ukraine. There's not much debate about this. By 1667, Russia is able to impose its will on what was the Cossack state. And then later, a century later, it gets the rest of what is Ukraine by taking Poland. But again, this is really important because so you have Kiev and what's called Left Bank Ukraine, that part that's closer to Russia. They've now been associated with Russia a full 100 years or more longer than other parts of Ukraine. So the part of Ukraine, and I'll show you that here's how the partitions of Poland, Russia, this part of Ukraine, right? So it had this after 1667, doesn't get this until the 1700s. So Western Ukraine is much more associated with Poland, with Europe, with the West, than it is with Russia for much longer. The severely Western part of Ukraine, what becomes part of Austria, you know, doesn't become part of Russia until after the Second World War. So that really identifies with the West in a way that, you know, even this part doesn't. So that's how it all gets incorporated. So by this point, we're up to the 19th century. All of Ukraine is part of Russia. 19th century is often referred to as the flowering of nations in Europe. Of course, we had the great political revolutions of the 18th century, our own and the French. But those were really about the people, right? About a civic people coming together on political principles. The 19th century is much more about ethnic identity, right? About identifying not just with one's nation, but with one's people, one's blood, one's Volk, as the Germans put it. And the Germans were really at the forefront of this. People like Herder and Schiller and the German Romantic poets, but also the French Romanticism. So this is the era when the Grimm brothers start gathering fairy tales, right? Because they represent the wisdom of the German people. And you know, all of Europe gets into this frenzy of, you know, finding our past. Who are we? What is our nation? You know, which Volk are we? And everyone around the Ukrainians is doing it too, right? The Poles are doing it. The Russians are doing it. So of course the Ukrainians are going to be part of it too. Everyone's nation building, or as I put, nation inventing, because there's quite a bit of creative act in all of this. And for the Ukrainians in particular, it's quite a battle to get Ukrainians to believe in themselves, right? Because there are all these competing ideas. Are they actually just a subset of Poles? Are they a subset of Russians? Are they Ruthenians? Sometimes I meet Ukrainian Americans in this country who will say, well, you know, I identify as a Ukrainian American, but my mother always said we were Ruthenians, right? You know, so they will even hold on to that Ruthenian identity. Or, you know, are we sub-Carpathians? That's a sub-identity of Ruthenians. So, but the Ukrainians participate in this, and they really begin to be quite active in creating Ukrainian national myths. Someone who's quite important in this is someone who you might know as Nikolai Gogol and as a great Russian writer, but who the Ukrainians know as Mykolai Hohol and consider a great Ukrainian writer, right? So Gogol actually wrote in both Ukrainian and Russian, and both cultures claim him. He himself said, I could not possibly choose what I am, right? I am both. That's inconvenient for both sides that he said that, but that's what he said. The other person who's very important for the Ukrainians is Taras Shevchenko. He's considered their national poet. And I forgot to bring it. I was going to read a couple excerpts from some of his poems that are in one of Andrew Wilson's books, but they're very much, you know, my beloved Ukraine, and, you know, about the land and the soul and of the people and the land and how they are united and all that kind of stuff that really everyone's national poet is writing at this time. And that I shouldn't be so dismissive about that, but they all do sound quite similar when you read them. This continues, right, this Ukrainian nation building. It particularly continues in that very western part that is part of Austria, because they just have more resources. And in fact, the Habsburg Empire is quite interested in kind of sponsoring this Ukrainian project, because it makes Russia mad, and they like doing that. So they sponsor, they actually create the first university in the city of Lviv, and they create a department of Ukrainian history. Now, you know, what does a people need more than a department of history, right? It needs people who can write its history and get it out there to the people. So the Habsburgs actually give a great gift to the Ukrainians by creating this Department of Ukrainian History. And it's first chaired by this guy named Mykhailo Hrushevsky. And he is so influential. He writes the first real history of Ukraine. He's doing a lot of inventing here, or I wouldn't say inventing, let's say shaping. And he's the first to claim that Rus, so this Kievan Rus that we've talked about, is really what he calls Ukraine-Rus, right? So it's no longer Kievan Rus, it's Ukraine Rus, right? So Ukraine was a state, that was its state. It was something, it was wonderful. And then big bad Moscow came, right? Muscovy came, it was bad, it was Eastern, it was savage, it was barbarian, it took us over. Conveniently forgetting that it was kind of the Mongols that did that. But they do a neat, he does a neat trick of saying, the Muscovites, the Russians, they're the ones who really, absorbed all the bad stuff from the Mongols. And then they tried to give it to us, right? We of Rus, we of Ukraine, we are European, we are civilized, right? We have this great history that we got cut off from because of the Muscovites, because of Moscow. They get a chance, so these Ukrainian nation builders, they get a chance to put this into action during World War I, which of course is this time of incredible flux, and we all know that how many nations were created out of World War I, right? Czechoslovakia, the Baltics, right? Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia. That's a great parallel with what's happening with Ukraine. The difference is that the Baltic states last a little bit longer after World War I than Ukraine does. This is the map that the Ukrainians brought to the Paris peace talks in 1919. This is what they wanted. This was their vision of what Ukraine was, right? That's why it's in French. And look what they claim. They claim Crimea, right? So it's much more expansive than some of those other maps we've seen of what earlier Ukrainian states were. It goes all the way over here to the left, right? So we get Lviv. So all that used to be part of Austria, of course, Austria loses the war, right? So they get a lot of their territory taken away. Ukraine says, we'll have that. We'll take that. And we'll take all of this, too, down into, what used to be part of Russia. We'll just, we'll take that. We're almost to the Volga here, right? It's a very expansive idea. And of course, we'll take Crimea as well. The Crimean Tatars were there too. They tried and failed to make the argument that they should have their own state. The Ukrainians do get acceptance of this state. The Ukrainian People's Republic exists for 3 years. This is one of their beautiful postcards about, you can see this here is Ukrainian Narodny Republic, Ukrainian National Republic, this beautiful Art Deco style, which is actually very much like the Czech national propaganda of the time as well, the Ukrainian flag, right? Unfortunately, the Russians had other ideas. Actually, it's the Bolsheviks that had other ideas. Ukraine was a site of the Civil War. Both whites and reds during the Russian Civil War wanted Ukraine. Terrible suffering in Ukraine during these years. They're trying to have this, independent state, but they end up falling to the Soviets in 1921. So we enter the period of Soviet Ukraine. As of 1921, and Ukraine remains part of the Soviet Union for the full 70 years. Ukraine had a particular status in the Soviet Union. It was a Soviet Socialist Republic. That's why it was the USSR. It was the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. It was an interesting form of ethno-federalism, where each of the states was based on a different ethnic group. And historians really have a debate about whether this Soviet ethno-federal system, was it a prison house of nations? Did it hold the nations down and back by making them learn Russian and forcing them to learn all this terrible Soviet propaganda? Or was it what some people call an incubator of nations? Because it actually gave them a state. It gave them something called Ukraine SSR. It couldn't go anywhere. I mean, and it was, subject to Moscow. It couldn't secede or anything like that. But, they went through the trouble of calling it that. It had borders. It had a name. It had an identity. So that's a debate that historians still have about the Soviet period. The Ukraine SSR had, of course, some really terrible experiences as part of the Soviet Union. The Great Purges of the 30s hit Ukraine very hard for the very reason that Stalin was suspicious of Ukrainian nationalists. Also, even preceding the purges, the famine of the early 1930s, of course, hit Ukraine terribly hard. This is another debate among historians. Was it, in fact, a genocidally intentional act on the point of Stalin? On the part of Stalin. Ukrainians today, of some stripes, believe that it was. And in fact, that's a good way to understand contemporary Ukrainian kind of a litmus test. Do you believe it was a genocide, you know, an intentional genocide on the part of Stalin? If you do, you're probably from the west of Ukraine. You probably, you know, really believe in Ukrainian independence. If you believe it was, of course, a horrible tragedy, but part of the overall Soviet experience, not really targeted at Ukrainians, you probably live in the east of Ukraine and identify more with Russia. No matter what your opinion on it was a horrific period. 7 million died between these two terrible events of the 30s. And then, of course, we went right into World War II, which was another horrific era. If any of you really are interested in that era and have a strong stomach, you can read Timothy Snyder's book called Bloodlands, which many of you might have already read. It's exactly about Ukraine and Belarus in World War II. It's incredibly well written, but very hard to read. So there are a lot of controversies about World War II in Ukraine. Remember, particularly those western parts of Ukraine that had been Austrian, they remember what life was like in Europe. They remember what life was like under the Austrians. And it wasn't great purges and famines, right? It was a lot better. So when Hitler and the Anschluss and, you know, all of a sudden, they're thinking this might be a way back. This might be a way back to Europe. They really are deluding themselves, right? Because they're Ukrainians, they're Slavs. We know what Hitler thought about Slavs. He thought they were subhuman and maybe fit to serve the Germans. Nevertheless, an organization of Ukrainian nationalists forms in Vienna back in the 30s. End up supporting Hitler's Germany, because they think Hitler will free their Ukrainian brethren from Stalin. Some of them even end up joining the SS. We had a Galician division of the SS that had a lot of ethnic Ukrainians in it. Things obviously change once Ukrainians get a sense of who Hitler really is and what his plan for people like Ukrainians really is, which is A, to have them help kill Jews. That's where part of the controversy comes from, whether or not and to what extent Ukrainians willingly participated in the Holocaust. They do, however, learn quite quickly and in a, you know, terrible fashion that the Germans are not interested in helping Ukrainians, right? The Germans are interested in enslaving them or killing them. So then you have kind of the morphing of this organization of Ukrainian nationalists into what is called the Ukrainian People's Army, which fights during World War II against the Germans, against the Soviets, against the Poles, basically against everybody, right? They're trying, you know, hoping beyond hope to carve another independent Ukraine out of this mess that is World War II. Obviously, that does not go well for them, right? And they are killed by Germans, Soviets, and Poles, and then are eventually recaptured, of course, by the Soviets. In terms of actual casualties, and again, it's hard to know whose figures to trust. We know it was just a horrific period for all involved. Official Soviet figures for the Ukrainian SSR during the war are almost 2 million military casualties, over 5 million civilian casualties. So, you know, another after, right, coming off the 30s. So just a horrific era. Then we have the other really important aspect of the Soviet experience for Ukraine is that they were given Crimea when Russia took over, the Bolsheviks took over in 1921, they took Crimea. It had been part of that independent Ukraine. Russia took it. They gave it back to Ukraine in 1954. And why? And why does it matter? So we'll just do a quick sort of detour about Crimea and what it significance it has. We already talked about it's where Christianization happened, so it has this religious significance. But then it was ruled by the Mongols and the Golden Horde, and then the Crimean Tatars. So these Turkic-speaking Muslim peoples ruled it for 300 years, right? Another thing Andrew Wilson says, if anybody has a claim to Crimea, it's not the Ukrainians and it's not the Russians, it's the Crimean Tatars who have the claim to it. Russia annexed it in 1783 by Catherine the Great. She created around it this territory called Nova Russia, which is why today's separatists in eastern Ukraine want to be called Nova Russia. They are again hearkening back to the imperial heritage. It was Crimea is where the Russians had a terrible defeat at the hands of the British during the Crimean War in the city of Sevastopol, right? The charge of the Light Brigade and things like that. So it's this sacred area that has been bathed in Russian blood. Coincidentally, or just interestingly, this is where Tolstoy first served, first saw battle. And he, by his own account, was sort of young and callous at that point, and wrote this very flowery thing about seeing the battle from on high and how beautiful it was. Then he came down and saw what it was really like, you know, to see people dying and suffering. And that's when he really had this sort of conversion to the kind of later pacifist Tolstoy that we know. So Sevastopol is important in that respect as well. It's an important site in World War II. It's captured by the Germans in 1942. They want that Black Sea access. When it's liberated by the Russians, quote unquote, in 44, they deport all the Crimean Tatars that were there, that were left there. A lot of them had left, you know, in between anyway. They'd been forced out by Catherine. They'd moved to Turkey. There were quite a few left, though, but Stalin moves them to Central Asia because he doesn't trust them. So why did was Ukraine given Crimea? Well, according to Khrushchev, who did this, it was a noble act on the part of the Russian people to commemorate the 3,000th anniversary of reunification and to evince the boundless trust and love the Russian people feel toward the Ukrainian people. Also, it was just close by, territorial proximity, and they had common economy and things like that. So that's a little bit about Soviet Ukraine. Of course, the Soviet Union falls in 91. Ukraine passes an act of independence in August of 1991. I include this here to show you that all Ukrainians supported this, or I won't say all, but many, right? It had 90% support when they had a referendum on it. So the Ukrainian people, such as they were at the time in 91, supported independence. Things then got very rough, though. In the 90s, Ukraine lost 60% of its GDP. At times, they had five-digit inflation. It was a horrible time. Their first president was a guy named Leonid Kravchuk. Second president is a guy named Leonid Kuchma, who's elected in 94. He tries to, you know, get a handle on the economy, creates a new currency, creates a new constitution. He's the one that gives up Ukraine's nuclear weapons. And the economy begins to stabilize in Ukraine in the 2000s. And this is when Ukraine starts to think, well, hey, our economy is done tanking. Maybe we can move closer to Europe. Europe is enlarging at this time. In 2004, Europe enlarges in what's called the Big Bang. They had 10 new entries that year, including Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, and Poland, all neighbors of Ukraine. Particularly Poland, right? Ukraine starts to think, if they can join the EU, why can't we? Ukraine signs a partnership cooperation agreement with the EU in 94, goes into force in 98. So, you know, they're starting to get ideas. They see the people around them joining Europe. Kuchma, who is their president, turns out to be horribly corrupt. He's implicated in the murder of a journalist. He's just a terrible guy. So Europe begins to turn against him, and he begins to turn against Europe. So while the Ukrainian people are starting to think, hey, maybe we can join Europe, turns out their government is actually sort of the same old terrible, you know, Soviet-style, politically and economically corrupt. He tries to turn Ukraine kind of away from Europe. So when he has to step down in 2004, there are new elections. He fixes them, right? His desired successor is Yanukovych, and the elections are pretty much fixed, so Yanukovych will win. This is what precipitates the Orange Revolution. Ukrainians come out into the street and say, you know, no, we will not let this horrible murdering president of ours pick our new president. We want new elections. They come out into the streets, they demand new elections, and they get them. Guy named Yushchenko becomes president. You probably remember him. He was the guy who was the victim of the dioxin poisoning. He was terribly scarred. So he, you know, people are so excited. This, you know, people are out in the square. They're wearing their orange because Yushchenko was smart. He knew if he used yellow and blue, which are the colors of Ukraine, that would just divide people because, of course, Ukrainians aren't sure what, you know, are they going to join Europe? Are they not? He says, I'll pick a nice neutral color, orange. So he's elected. He picks Yulia Tymoshenko. She's the one with the braids that was is later jailed. Everyone's so excited because these two have won and the evil bad Yanukovych lost. But they turn out to be corrupt. They can't work together. The Orange Revolution fails. Yanukovych, who was this hand-picked successor to the real corrupt guy, is still popular with particularly a lot of those folks in the East who are more identified with Russia. He becomes prime minister in 2006. There are these gas wars with Russia. You know, it's winter, it's freezing, the gas gets turned off. People blame Yushchenko and Tymoshenko. Then we have the economic crisis in 2008. Ukraine loses, again, a large chunk of its GDP, and inflation comes back. Nevertheless, in 2009, Ukraine takes another big step towards the EU. It joins what's called the EU's Eastern Partnership, which is a special program that the EU has started to bring in countries like Ukraine to basically get them away from Russia. And Yanukovych is elected president in 2010 with 48% of the vote. So these two, the Orange Revolution guys, are out. They're discredited. Yanukovych is back in. And Yanukovych, you know, he's a smart guy. He turns out to be a thug, but he's a smart thug. And he says he's committed to a European path. He makes plans to sign the association agreement with the EU. You know, he does seem to think that Ukraine can become a little European. Ukraine took part in the Eurovision Song Contest, which, if you don't know about it, it's basically American Idol, but each contestant represents a European country. Ukraine actually won this in 2004. It hosts the European Football Championships in 2012. You know, so Yanukovych understands that there are benefits to being seen as European and to getting close to Europe. But being post-Soviet is also, you know, being close to Russia, remembering your Soviet heritage, is also lucrative, as you can steal anything you want and, you know, take anything you want, which, of course, you're not supposed to be able to do in Europe, although people do it. It's comfortable to be post-Soviet. No one's going to think you're crude. No one's going to think you're, you know, just a rube from the East. It's also easier, especially if you're from the East or the South of Ukraine. You probably speak Russian, right? You were probably have been part of Russia. You know, you're that part of from that part of Ukraine that has been Russian for much longer. So this explains why Yanukovych ultimately, you know, decided to choose to not go towards Europe and instead to stay with this post-Soviet path. But why does Putin go so crazy when this Maidan movement happens in Ukraine? Because Putin 1.0, the sort of first Putin, had actually tried to work with Europe. He had addressed the Bundestag in Germany in German. He said, you know, we're part of a common home and things like that. Putin 2.0 is entirely different. So what changes? Why does he go so crazy when Ukraine, you know, makes this popular choice, overthrows Yanukovych, and decides to go for Europe? Well, a lot has changed that makes Putin nervous. We have the Afghan and Iraq invasions. He's worried about America sort of being on his doorstep in the Far East. The color revolutions have happened, not just in Ukraine, but in Georgia. The Baltic states joined NATO in 2004. That was upsetting. He was very upset by Kosovo's declaration of independence and our support of Kosovo in 2008. And he decides to sort of test the waters, see what will happen if he invades or pokes another European-leaning post-Soviet state, which is Georgia, in 2009. You might remember that war. What happens is nothing. The West does nothing. It can't do anything. It's not going to go in with tanks to save Georgia. So he says, okay, you know, I can use force. Nobody's going to respond. So we talked a little bit about this already. Putin comes back in 2012, says he's going to run for president again. The popular rest starts to grow. There are these protests against him. He's really shocked. He can't believe people aren't excited for him to come back. Put that together with the kind of paranoia that he's feeling in the international system, you know, that the West is out to get him, NATO's growing, NATO and the US are behind all this unrest in Georgia and Ukraine and others. Combine that with the unrest at home, and he's, you know, sitting on eggshells already when this Maidan thing happens. So Putin sees himself in Yanukovych. He has a real fear of this Euromaidan happening at home. So he clamps down and he decides he's going to double down on this kind of Russian nationalist strategy at home. He sees the Euromaidan phenomena in Ukraine as part of a larger Western or NATO plot to destroy Russia. There's this unresolved question of Russia's identity. Is it just a normal state now, or is it still an empire? Think of all those maps we saw where much of Ukraine was part of Russia's territory. It's hard to let that go. So he decides he can kind of, you know, kill all these birds with one stone, and he can appeal to an older, deeper sense of patriotism in Russia, a sense of humiliation, a desire for restoration. This will help strengthen him at home, but it will also, you know, take care of some of that unease that Russia feels in the world. So by taking Crimea and clamping down on Ukraine, he can restore greatness, stability, and things like that. So where does Ukraine stand today? There's a lot of unity around Poroshenko. There's a lot of unity around the idea that Ukraine should be independent. So almost, again, 90% of Ukrainians, that's pretty consistent from 91, want Ukraine to be independent. They don't want to join Russia. There's a strong majority that support EU membership, almost 70%. That's gone up since Putin decided to invade. For the first time, a bare majority favor NATO membership. That's the first time there's ever been a majority since Putin invaded. 90% of Ukrainians disapprove of Putin and say Russia does not have the right to interfere even with Russian speakers in Ukraine. Nevertheless, there are real divides in Ukraine. As we saw in the Ukrainian identified West, that part that was Galicia, that was Austria, there's a very strong European identity. Sorry, there's another typo. There's a very strong pro-Russian identity, or pro-Eurasian Union, that's Putin's plan to unite the former Soviet Union, in the Donbass and in the Southwest. And you can see this in this graph. This shows you the ethno-linguistic and political divisions in Ukraine. So again, this West is mostly Ukrainian-speaking. This is the part that was part of Austria. This is the part that, you know, just thinks it's a no-brainer that Ukraine is part of Europe. But then you get down here, this is mostly Russian-speaking. This is predominantly Russian-speaking. This is ethnic Russians. So not just that they speak Russian, they ethnically identify as Russians and not Ukrainians. Now, not all these folks, remember, only 10% of the country wants to, you know, join with Europe. It's pretty clear that those folks live here. But this represents 27% of the population. So, you know, only less than half of these people who are ethnic Russians and speak Russian actually want to join Russia, right? There's a significant percentage even of these Western, Southern Russian speakers who want to stay a unified Ukraine. But there are these real differences, and these show up in presidential elections, these show up in opinion polls. But I think the thing to focus on is that overall 90% of Ukrainians want to stay united, and 90% of Ukrainians don't believe Russia has the right to interfere. So where's Russia stand today? Putin is still extremely popular. I saw numbers from May that showed him at 91% approval rating. His information war is working. First of all, this points out that his plan, well, you know, by invading Crimea, by invading Ukraine, I can pull on these historical patriotic heartstrings and consolidate my popularity at home. That worked. It worked. It really worked. Also, his information war, the idea that this is all our fault, that this was all a plot by us, that's working too. 81% of Russians have a negative or very negative opinion on the U.S. 71% have a very negative opinion of the EU. Again, the economy's in trouble, it doesn't seem to matter. In terms of what's going to be the end game, though, for Russia in Ukraine, for this Donbass region or this Novorossiya region, I heard a commentator on Radio Free Europe the other day say, well, someone said, well, what's the end game? And he said, well, the end game is there is no end game, right? Putin does not have a plan. He does not know what he's doing here. It actually serves him quite well to leave it ambiguous. And, as long as this low-level fighting continues there, Europe is not really going to make many moves towards incorporating Ukraine. As long as the fighting continues, he can keep exploiting those divides in Ukraine. And it, you know, obviously is so good for his ratings at home. I think he's happy to just keep it in this state of limbo. So conclusions, old answers to old questions. Is Ukraine a separate country? Ukrainians say yes, Russians say no. You can see different moments in the past when Ukraine has said yes and Russia has said no. Is Ukraine European? Well, maybe. The former Galicians, those people in the West, are sure. Poland is sure. Russia is sure that it's not, except when it is sure that it is. Because, and this is... this is something I write about in the book manuscript I'm writing. It's very useful for Russia right now to say Europe is bad, Europe is the enemy, Ukraine is not part of Europe, we are not part of Europe. Again, I would look back a few years to the speeches that Putin was giving to the Bundestag and others when he was saying, we are Europe, we are all Europe, right? So I wouldn't be surprised if very soon Russia and Ukraine are Europe again. Again, is Russia a state or an empire? Yes. Both and, right? It's the same questions, it's the same confusion. So anyway, I talked way too long, but and threw a lot of information at you, but I hope we have a few minutes for questions anyway. Thank you.
I'm confused about the language and the between Poland and Ukraine, Russia, because you have different alphabets.
Right, exactly, and that is in fact very intentional. I mean, while there are, and this goes back to that nation building or nation inventing in the 19th century, and those. The poets are important, the historians are important, but so are the linguists. The folks who go through and compile the first dictionaries of the Polish language, of the Lithuanian language, of the Ukrainian language, because yeah, they really have to pick which dialect, right? Which dialect is going to be different enough that we can say, well, this is Ukrainian and not Polish, right? Or this is Ukrainian and not Russian. So you're right. It's a very distinct choice. They pick they picked the dialects that were the most different and then created these orthographies, these alphabets that were even more distinct, right? So, and that changes over time. When the Soviets, you know, one of the things the Soviets did, and that's why this question of were the Soviets, did they hold nations prisoner or did they create nations? Because one of the things they did was create alphabets for lots of people that didn't have them before. Now, the Ukrainians did, and one thing, but the Russians allowed them to have their own language, their own alphabet, right? They all had to learn Russian too. But they did allow Ukrainian to exist. Now it's really interesting if you talk to Ukrainians who were Ukrainian Americans whose either parents were immigrants or you know they grew up learning Ukrainian here, let's say either after World War I or World War II in places like you know Syracuse and Rochester and Pittsburgh, they speak what Ukrainians today consider they call it clean Ukrainian, right? They speak this kind of pure old Ukrainian that was not diluted by Russian and all these Soviet terms and things like that. So they can understand each other, but it's, you know, they, it's a sort of a different dialect. So you're right, you're right. It that's such an interesting history. And each people of the Soviet Union, each people of Europe, you know, have this process by which their language was created and invented.
How important are the port facilities in the Crimea to Russia?
That's a very good question. She asked, how important are the port facilities in Crimea? And that's a real, I'm glad you mentioned that because the port of Sevastopol, where Tolstoy witnessed this battle in the Crimean War, that was the main port for the Black Sea Fleet, for the Soviet Black Sea Fleet. And before Russia took over Crimea in last year, they were always negotiating with Ukraine about the lease for that naval base. And they had made it work, sort of, right? They kept going back and forth, and the Ukrainians had allowed the Russian Navy, you know, to continue to use that naval base at Sevastopol. But of course, they would find ways to stymie it as well, right? They would say, well, you can use the naval base, but you can't bring anything overland by rail to supply it, right? You know, they made it really hard for them to actually use it. So certainly Russia wanted that, you know, full access, full control of that base back. And in fact, the fact that base is there and that it really is the most important part of Crimea as well in terms of economic life and things like that. A lot of the Russians who live there, it's mostly ethnic Russians who live in Crimea, and particularly the ones that are in Sevastopol are, you know, military types, sort of diehard, you know, Soviet Russian patriot types. So that's why, you know, I don't say I agree at all with Russia's decision to come in and take Crimea, but I do agree that the one part of the story that Russia is telling that is true is that Crimeans, in terms of the citizens who live there now, with the exception of those few Crimean Tatars who are still there, overwhelmingly they are happy to be back with Russia because most of them are ethnic Russians. Most of them don't feel Ukrainian. They identify with that naval base. They identify with that Soviet history. So yeah, the port is very important.
Is there a consensus or a sense of developing consensus on the part of young Ukrainian people, what we would call the millennials, who will be taking over power in the future? Do we know how they feel or if they are going to take up the fight or if they have any interest to do this?
Yeah, no, that's a wonderful question. And the answer is yes. And overwhelmingly, they identify with this Euromaidan, this European vision. There are a few exceptions. So for example, one of the things Yanukovych was doing was grooming his son, you know, to sort of be the heir, and he, you know, owned a ridiculous amount of property and things in Ukraine. You know, there's a small segment of, I would say, the old Soviet elite, their children, who have a stake in the sort of old style. But for most normal, right, young people, they understand that system is closed off to them, right? That doesn't work for them. They don't want that. You know, that's why Europe represents to them rule of law, opportunity. One of the things that Europe has done really well, you know, there's often a lot of talk that Europe has not supported Ukraine enough in terms of monetary aid or military aid, but they do send lots of young Ukrainians for university education in Europe. They make it very easy for young Ukrainians to visit Europe on tourist visas and things like that, and they really support civil society organizations and things like that. So I feel very comfortable saying that, yes, among the young generation, there's a real commitment to a different type of Ukraine, a new Ukraine.
Fascinating presentation.
Oh, thank you.
What is your take on the allegation that Jim Baker, when he was Secretary of State, at the time that of the unification of Germany, promised, I believe it was Gorbachev at the time, that there would be no eastward movement of NATO, and yet there was.
Yeah, that, I'm so glad you brought that up, because of course that is now Putin's big mantra, right? You told Gorbachev this would never happen, and you know, look at this happening. It's interesting, if you go to NATO's webpage, throughout this crisis, they keep adding to it. First it was the five things Russia is lying about. Now, you know, then it was the 10 things Russia is lying about, and now it's like a five-page document. But there, you know, NATO has sort of felt the need to defend itself, right? And it goes through point and says, look, you know, we never promised Gorbachev that we weren't going to do this. And in fact, we have worked with Russia throughout the post-Soviet period exactly to allay its fears, right? And it's true. I have a chapter about this in the manuscript I'm writing too, right? NATO has bent over backwards to give Russia access. It created this thing called the NATO-Russia Council. That even wasn't enough for Russia, right? Russia said, well, especially if you're going to enlarge, we'd really like to be there. We really would like to see. We want to sit at the table and make sure, you know, you're not going to be planning these nefarious things against Russia. NATO said, okay. They created this thing called the 20 plus 1 Council, where Russia's representative got to sit with the other NATO defense ministers, you know, in plenary meetings and things like this, right? I mean, NATO did a lot, I think, to try to allay Russia's fears about expansion. And it's not, of course, that's NATO saying that, right? It would have to say that. But there's a guy named Mark Kramer who teaches at Princeton, and he heads the Cold War History Project, which is fascinating. They put out a book a few years ago called Argument Without End, which brought together Robert McNamara and his counterparts in Vietnam, and they from both North and South Vietnam, and they talked, you know, openly about, well, what did you believe and what did you believe, right? And they've done this with Berlin and all kinds of interesting things. And Mark Kramer wrote an article even before any of this started. I believe it was from 2009, where he was debunking the myth of NATO's no expansion pledge. My sense, I'm convinced by that, right? If you look at how NATO acted in terms of their willingness to give access to Russia, I think it's convenient for Russia to say that. I think the real problem is not that NATO is expanding, it just is expanding too far, right? I mean, it was okay to let the Baltics go. They didn't really count. But Ukraine is something entirely different for all the reasons we've seen here, right? And in a way, I mean, while I'm very sympathetic to Ukraine's desire to be European and join NATO and join the EU, you know, it is different, right? It would be something different psychologically and in terms of security for Russia to lose Ukraine. And it would be very hard for Russia to not see that as a loss. I mean, yeah, it's a loss of the Baltics too, but you never had them for very long and they're tiny and, you know, let them go, right? Ukraine is something really different. So I would say there wasn't a no expansion pledge, but Russia probably believed that it would never get as far as it did, and now that it has, they're really pushing back.
I think we have to end there.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.